Just when the weather is glorious, they come up. They attack us and ruin our day. So every summer, we get out our swatters, sprays, and repellents until they drive us indoors. It's us against them. They emerge by the millions. They can navigate at night by moon and stars. They can walk upside down on a flower. From the top of the world almost to the bottom, they bombard us on every continent except Antarctica. Mosquitoes are one of the most studied creatures on the planet. It's the female mosquito that matters.
It's the fact that females are the ones who are driving these systems that I found so interesting. It's the female who just has this immense drive to reproduce.
Fiona Hunter is a medical entomologist at Brock University.
It's the female who has to get a blood meal in order to mature a batch of eggs. It's all about her passing on her genes to the next generation.
Working with mosquitoes is a fiddly business, but at Hunter's lab, the female mosquito still charms her.
I think female mosquitoes are fantastic. They are beautiful. They're so versatile that they, against all odds, survive. They're amazing.
But she's hell-bent on biting us, leaving us fearing the diseases she transmits.
She's a blood sucker, and by doing that, she's actually able to pass pathogens from animals to humans, or from animals to animals, or even humans to humans. So she's the one who's the driving force of all the anguish that we feel when we hear mosquitoes buzzing.
This summer pest needs us. She's attuned to us. She senses our movement. While we're out there enjoying the warm weather, she attacks. Her compound eyes keep us in her field of vision. But we're only silhouettes to her. Our body odor is the big giveaway. The chemicals we give off, like carbon dioxide and lactic acid, entice her. She uses her antennae to smell us. They may be less bushy than the males, but they do their job, wafting our scents toward her. The more we swat, the sweatier we get, and the more chemicals we release, and the easier it is for her to find us and take a bite. She alights on our skin and probes ever so gently for the perfect spot to jab with her tiny proboscis. It's a loaded barrel. Inside, there's a spear for piercing our skin and two tubes. Through one, she administers an anesthetic and an anticoagulant. Through the other, she sucks blood. The iron and protein in it are what she needs to develop her eggs. But now, she's too heavy to fly. So first, she digests her meal and eliminates water. Then, sniffing around, she searches out a place to lay her eggs, where others have already been laid.
This is prime mosquito habitat. It's nice and damp. The adult females can actually rest in the vegetation during the heat of the day, so they're not going to dry out. And the convenient thing is that we have standing water right next to this area where the females can be laying their eggs.
She lays her eggs either singly or in a raft, and either in mud or pools of water. As she squeezes out her eggs, sperm stored in a special pouch fertilizes them. She'll do this again, feeding and laying eggs, until her life ends several days later.
She's not much of a mother. All she does is lays her eggs and leaves them, and who knows what's going to happen to them.
Her offspring start their lives as tiny larvae. At this stage, they're perfect underwater creatures that breathe through a siphon at the surface of the water. Their whiskers create water currents that drive food to their hungry mouths. But it's a violent world they live in. As they wriggle around, molting through four stages, only a fraction survive. The lucky ones turn into comma-shaped pupae, which tumble about, until a fully formed mosquito splits open its case and crawls out. She gets her insect blood pumping and almost immediately has liftoff. Slow motion shows that she beats her wings up to 1,000 times per second. Within a day or two, she has matured. And now, she needs a mate to fertilize her eggs. There are lots of males waiting for her. Tracking software reveals what goes on. He's blue, she's red. She enters the swarm and flies around its lower half, faster than all the males, until a lucky one catches up with her. How do they hook up? They sing to each other. Hold a male mosquito and a female up to a microphone, and this is what you'll hear. Now the flirting and foreplay begin. And then it happens. Here it is in real time. She's on top, of course. And that's it for the male. The end of his life is near.
Really, a male's only job is to sip on a little nectar, get some sugar in him so that he has enough energy to fly around and find a female, and then to mate.
After ditching him, she puts the moves on us. But who to get intimate with? Is it you over others? Women over men? Blondes over brunettes. It's more complicated than that. She's after the one giving off the most enticing chemicals.
You know, you have these insects that are flying through what you might imagine is a sort of aerial soup of chemicals being given off by everything in the environment, yet they're so sophisticated that they know to ignore those chemicals and focus in on the ones that are coming from us or from their breeding site. And, you know, just understanding that sort of hidden world of communication is absolutely fascinating.
James Logan is a medical entomologist.
Well, we're actually sort of down in the dungeons of the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. And down in these vaults, we've got lots of different mosquito species.
Logan collects these for his research on mosquitoes and our body odor.
Yes, that's right. So I am the guru on smell, so I guess I call myself a chemical ecologist, and that means I'm interested in trying to find out how insects use their sense of smell to find us. Okay, so we're going to do an experiment to find out how attractive you are to mosquitoes.
Logan uses this wind tunnel to come up with two groups of people, those who are most, and more importantly, least attractive to mosquitoes.
To collect your body odor, we use this foil bag. And if you just sort of
There are 500 chemicals in our body odor. He wants to know exactly which ones attract mosquitoes.
And we're going to seal it just around your neck, very, very, very gently.
So first, he has a volunteer slip into an inflatable bag.
And your head, and if you just turn and put your feet on the...
Then, with tubes connected, he sends purified air over her. This directs her body odors to a filter that traps them. It takes about 2 hours, plenty long enough to feel...
Hot. Is it hot?
Next, Logan runs her chemicals past a mosquito. For that, some microscopic surgery is required. All he needs are the mosquito's antennae, so he severs her head. It's delicate work.
I've kind of lost the head.
He begins again, and this time he manages to attach a pair of very fine glass electrodes to her antennae, which remain active for a while. That creates a circuit, and as he directs the body odors across the antennae, the mosquito reacts, creating electrical signals.
So here, for example, you can see there's a nice big response from the antenna to this chemical here.
His computer program matches the mosquito's responses to actual chemicals. And voila, they're identified.
Seal the bag, right?
After hundreds of tests, Logan will know which chemicals in our body odor mosquitoes don't like. From that, he'll create a natural repellent. Ultimately, Logan's hope is to find a way to block the mosquitoes' receptors so they can't smell us in the first place.
Every day we sort of get an inch further, an inch closer to understanding more about these insects that spread these devastating diseases.
West Nile is one of the most serious diseases transmitted by mosquitoes. It hit Canada via Europe and the United States in 2002. And that's when Fiona Hunter got hooked.
Mosquitoes were not, I admit, my first love.
But then they got under her skin.
I had a lab capable of identifying biting insects. So it was sort of thrust upon us that, and a sense of duty, that I better jump in and do something.
Now Hunter is an authority on them. And assisted by Ainsley Thielman, a research scientist, she runs a government-funded surveillance program that roots out dangerous mosquitoes and their viruses. Across Ontario, teams set mosquito traps nightly. They use dry ice as bait to entice them with its delicious animal-like smell of carbon dioxide. It works. The traps are sent to Hunter's facility. The millions of mosquitoes that arrive daily are sorted by species. It's the dangerous ones Hunter's team is looking for, the ones that carry the West Nile virus or worse. It's meticulous work, but critical.
I think that with climate changing and invasive species coming into Canada, we're going to see more mosquito-borne diseases.
It just takes one. But the question is, which kind of mosquito just bit us? The Natural History Museum in London, England, holds one of the largest collections of mosquitoes in the world. The museum's authority on mosquitoes is Ralph Harbach. Ask him what's fascinating about them.
The diversity of mosquitoes, not just the form of how they look. Some are beautiful, gorgeous, with metallic blues and greens. Others are very drab and ugly.
In a cooled and sealed room in the museum's basement, rows of cabinets store 500,000 mosquitoes. Most of them were found in countries of the British Empire. Each specimen is a valuable reference, like this ancient mosquito preserved in amber.
The earliest fossil mosquito we have comes from the Cretaceous, which is somewhere around 100 million years old. toward the end of the reign of the dinosaurs. And we think that mosquitoes probably evolved even a bit earlier than that.
Some scientists theorize that mosquitoes, along with other insects, are linked to the death of dinosaurs. That's because traces of deadly diseases have been found inside ancient mosquito specimens. There's no speculation when it comes to humans.
Mosquitoes are the indirect cause of more morbidity and mortality than any other organism on the planet. The key word is indirect, because they're not causing the disease. They're just transmitting the organisms into the human body that cause the disease.
Not all mosquitoes transmit disease.
Of the 3,523 species that we currently recognize, there are only perhaps 150 that are nuisance or transmit diseases, perhaps 200 at most.
Those 200 mosquito species belong, by and large, to just three groups, Culex, Anopheles, and Aedes. They're the most dangerous mosquitoes on the planet, and the ones that need to be controlled.
If you're going to control mosquitoes, kill them so that they're not a nuisance or not there to transmit disease, you have to know something about their behavior and their ecology.
First up is Culex. She's the common household mosquito around the world and the transmitter of the West Nile virus. That makes her the most dangerous mosquito in Canada. She likes to breed in polluted pools of water, laying hundreds of eggs in rafts every few days. Culex mosquitoes are bird biters. If the bird has the West Nile virus, she picks it up, and if a person is handy, passes it on.
You wouldn't think that an insect that is attracted to a bird would also be attracted to a human. We look different, we smell different, we live in different environments.
But she does like our blood too, so she bites whichever of us is more available. Next, the Anopheles mosquito. She's the world's most dangerous mosquito because she transmits the malaria parasite. Anopheles live in Canada too, but with no parasite here for her to transmit, she's just a nuisance. She calls wetlands home. That's where Ainsley Thielman dips for larvae that she will rear in a lab.
There's about 5 different species of Anopheles in Canada, and all of them, this is their most ideal habitat, ponds that have a lot of algae, because I think they like to rest on top of the algae.
More than 200 years ago, these mosquitoes transmitted a mild form of malaria called ague. President Lincoln suffered its chills and fevers. So did Elizabeth Simcoe, wife of the first Lieutenant Governor of Canada. And so did the workers building the Rideau Canal. None of them knew it came from a mosquito bite. Some Anopheles could do it again today if the parasite were to come back. Chris Drakely is the director of the Malaria Center at the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine in England.
What we have here is a female Anopheles mosquito, and this is the proboscis through which it injects its saliva into the human host when it's seeking a blood meal.
When it's a malaria victim she bites, thousands of tiny parasites in the blood meal enter her body. They head straight to her stomach and rest on the outside of it, taking about a week to develop.
So what I'm doing here is looking at the stomach of a mosquito that fed some time ago on an infected person. So here are a group of parasites on the outside of the stomach there.
Then the parasites move into her salivary glands. And as she bites the next person, she passes the parasites on. They grow and divide in the liver and then burst back into the bloodstream, ready to become part of another mosquito's blood meal. The person is now sick with malaria. But what about the mosquito?
There are some evidence from laboratory work that suggests if you give mosquitoes a lot of malaria, feed them on a very heavy blood meal, then they do die. You imagine these parasites punching holes in the mosquito's stomach, it might end up a little bit like a tea bag if there's too many.
The third mosquito to watch out for is the Aedes. These mosquitoes search out fresh puddles in a marsh, a tire, or a bird bath. Puddles can be created by snow melting over eggs laid the previous year. Come spring, especially in the far north, they hatch by the millions and feast on people and any other animal passing by. A couple of Aedes mosquito species are dangerous. They spread viruses like dengue fever. One is known as the Asian tiger. Hunter found a couple of them in Ontario 10 years ago.
It had never been recorded in Canada before. And of course, Asian tiger mosquito can transmit all sorts of very nasty diseases.
Now, she keeps a trap at the top of a tower near the US border for monitoring mosquitoes migrating into Canada. When an Aedes mosquito picks up a virus, it spreads throughout her body, taking 8 to 10 days to develop, before ending up in her saliva, ready to be injected into a person.
So you can actually pull off the legs of an infected mosquito, and they'll have virus in them because that mosquito is so saturated in its insect blood with virus.
Why do some mosquitoes pick up and transmit a virus or parasite while others don't? That's what Carl Loewenberger, a parasitologist at Simon Fraser University, wants to know. To keep his mosquitoes breeding, he lets them suck blood out of his own arm.
Because I've done this as many times as I have, I initially feel the little pinprick as she inserts a proboscis into the skin. After that, you don't feel anything at all.
He uses ice to anesthetize them.
These are our experimental animals, which are highly valuable. Most people don't consider mosquitoes to be valuable, but in fact, we think they're tremendously exciting.
These are Aedes aegypti, which can transmit a virus like dengue, but never a parasite. Loewenberger wants to know why.
We try to figure out when a pathogen or parasite gets in, how does the mosquito recognize it as not being part of the mosquito? How do immune systems work? How do they evolve? How does a parasite get around the immune system of the insect it's going into?
To find out, he'll give this one a dose of parasites.
And essentially what we do is we inject the parasites just through the neck membrane so that they can swim through the body cavity of the insect.
Once the parasites are developed, the mosquitoes are dissected. It takes about 1,000 of them to obtain enough body fluids to work on. In these body fluids are the proteins that the mosquito uses to reject or destroy the parasites. Loewenberger is identifying these proteins at the genetic level and creating a profile of the genes the mosquito uses to reject the parasites.
In this case, what we're seeing is all these peaks represent different proteins.
Ultimately, he could replicate these genes so that disease-carrying mosquitoes would reject parasites and viruses.
We don't expect to be able to eliminate Aedes aegypti from the world. We would just be perfectly happy if Aedes aegypti could no longer transmit dengue virus to humans.
Until then, she's on the loose, and we're on the chase.
And there's a state of emergency as the Fraser River overflows its banks in southern British Columbia.
Blame it on climate change or increased unpredictability of weather. But in the summer of 2012, British Columbia suffered its worst flood in 40 years. Who would have thought that BC would also be home to a mosquito invasion? Michael Jackson is an entomologist who runs Culex Environmental, a mosquito control service. When he saw the river rising, he knew immediate action was necessary, or millions of Aedes mosquitoes would be unleashed.
I'm seeing adult mosquitoes that, as the sun comes up, they tend to hide in the grass.
Heavy snow, then heavy rain, then hot temperatures raised the water, and it washed across the shores where hundreds of thousands of mosquito eggs, many laid years ago, were lying dormant.
Mosquitoes must have been thinking, you know, all that effort that I put into laying all those eggs is finally going to pay off. Some eggs are triggered to hatch on the first flood. Other eggs will wait until they're flooded twice before they hatch, and others will wait 3 years.
Where exactly were they hatching? They'd soon turn into adults if Jackson couldn't kill them first. So he mustered his troops. They found Culex larvae, potential carriers of the West Nile virus, in this murky ditch. And Aedes larvae in this flooded field. They sprayed them with a larvicide that's safe to humans and the environment. And here, where mosquitoes had bred under cottonwood trees, Jackson even employed a helicopter and hopper to target them close to the ground.
We obviously try to deal with as many of the larvae as we can, but there's always going to be some that get away.
So, was the BC flood a freak occurrence or a sign of things to come?
We don't know if in the long term what the effects of global warming and climate change may be. Everybody is by now aware that there's something that's happening to our planet here, which is not, you know, good.
All over the world, environments are changing dramatically, and mosquitoes are taking advantage. In the worst cases, a couple of Aedes species are spreading dengue fever. Also known as breakbone disease, dengue can be deadly. Half the world's population is now at risk of it. Robin Lindsay is chief of field studies at the National Biological Laboratory in Winnipeg. Lindsay is on Canada's front line when it comes to tracking potentially dangerous mosquitoes.
They are what I like to call hardwired. They do things on an instinctual basis. They don't think about what they're doing. They just do things. So they are certainly able to take advantage of opportunities as they present themselves.
This is Dhaka, the capital of Bangladesh, and a hotspot for dengue fever. For Aedes mosquitoes, Dhaka is paradise.
What we're seeing here is this obviously tropical vegetation. You can't feel the heat here, but this area is very tropical based on the heat and humidity, and this creates a perfect environment for mosquitoes. Hosts in the front, living quarters in the back.
Aedes mosquitoes love the humidity, but need fresh, still water for breeding. So where are they hiding? That's why Lindsay is here.
Because there's no way that... This is fascinating. I keep a colony of these mosquitoes back in Winnipeg, but to see them in the flesh, so to speak, is quite amazing. They're almost like the field mouse of the mosquito world. They're completely adapted to living in human habitations.
Some of them are coiled.
Lindsay is kickstarting a surveillance program at Dhaka's North-South University.
Because I know many of his research fellows have looked over the sheets and have some questions.
He's plotted out the city on a grid and assigned teams to cover each area.
And he's found containers with water.
Lindsay was brought to Bangladesh by Emdad Haq.
So what we need to do, we need to throw the dice and get that number and then walk to that house.
Haq is a professor at the University of Manitoba, but he was born and raised in Bangladesh, and this project is his brainchild. It's a 4-year study of how social and environmental changes affect the spread of dengue.
This project could be a milestone for the entire region, So we are hoping that we can, you know, create a new frontier and work together with the community here in the Asian regions.
Dhaka is the world's newest megacity. Millions of migrants from the countryside are moving in, pushing the population toward 20 million. It's the thriving textile and garment industry they've come for. But the city can't keep up with them. There's an explosion of slums and high-rises. And mosquitoes are making the most of it.
Mosquito is part of life here, but the frontier with mosquito got changed. It used to be bushy wetland. You can see around, I mean, still just behind this, those are wetlands. And you can see that it used to be wetland flora and fauna.
There were always mosquitoes here, but the new buildings created a habitat for dengue carriers.
When you go and survey these houses, it's very hard to find the mosquitoes. They're there and they're biting people, but the abundance is quite low.
The best way to count them is to add up the larvae and pupae breeding in water containers. This house is mosquito-free, but outside it, the team finds larvae. And then they find some at a construction site. This is an eye-opener. Puddles are ignored in places like this by everyone, except the dengue-bearing mosquito. In Bangladesh, dengue fever used to be called Dhaka fever. Dhaka Medical College Hospital admits 6 to 8 dengue fever patients daily.
This has come from mosquito bite, no doubt about that.
In 2000, there was a major outbreak. It was an epidemic. More than officially 5,000 people got hospitalized, but our prediction it could be more than 10,000.
Today, the team has come to a slum. In Dhaka, dengue is perceived as a disease of the affluent. That's because the rich get hospital treatment and their cases are recorded. The poor get sick below the radar. But the Aedes mosquito, it seems, does not discriminate. There's standing water here too, and larvae are breeding in it.
Larva and pupa.
In the end, larvae mostly showed up where this stressed city's water systems are inadequate.
Wait, what is this?
This is a jeptai. They said that there are some. It takes some samples.
So, in Dhaka, are disease-bearing mosquitoes the price of progress? Worse, are they winning the battle?
Yeah, I don't even think it's a draw right now. They are, in places like this, and even in North America, they're in many ways are winning.
For Emdad Haq, trying to stay on top of the dengue-bearing mosquito is an endless task.
First, you are trying to understand what is the transmission process, and then we'll try with some intervention. So from there, we'll learn, and again, and we'll come back, and we'll sort of continue to work. So it's an impossible task. I do agree, but we cannot give up.
What's happening in Dhaka repeats itself across Southeast Asia. Mosquitoes are thriving hand in hand with rapid urban expansion. They're also flourishing because of globalization. With so much international travel, mosquitoes can hitch a ride, settle in, and spread diseases. Back home, Robin Lindsay keeps his eyes peeled for dengue-bearing mosquitoes, particularly the Asian tiger, which is creeping north, up through the United States, toward Canada.
If climate change continues to expand the potential range of that mosquito, it's certainly theoretically possible that we could have dengue cases occurring here.
Our troubles with mosquitoes are getting worse. There must be something we can do, isn't there? They zap us. How do we zap them? Scientists have come up with hundreds of ideas, like this laser zapper that's triggered by wing beats. Or this pesticide-laden paint that kills them on contact. Predators are being introduced to devour larvae, and insect-eating plants are being grown in malaria-infested areas. Fiona Hunter and Ainsley Thielman are testing a garlic-based mosquito repellent, but...
Obviously, with this many mosquitoes in the trap, the garlic isn't having a huge effect.
Finding something that works is never ending.
I think if we look at all the efforts that we're making to try and control mosquitoes, they just keep one step ahead of us, I think. That every time we come up with something, they evolve a counter strategy to outwit us.
Once we thought we had a perfect tool. In the 1940s and 50s, we sprayed DDT to fight malaria in parts of Asia, North and South America, Africa, Australia, and Europe. In Sardinia alone, about 250 tons of it were sprayed on every mosquito habitat. 5 years and $7 million later, malaria was gone. DDT was the super insecticide. Until...
The public was being asked to accept these chemicals, was being asked to acquiesce in their use.
Rachel Carson wrote Silent Spring, exposing its repercussions through the food chain. In the 1970s, DDT was banned in Canada and the US, and eventually in most of the world, even for fighting malaria. Nothing could replace it, and the ban was recently lifted in high-risk areas. For mosquitoes, the ban didn't matter. They were already ahead of the game. Mosquitoes can develop a resistance to insecticides. Their exoskeletons can absorb them and form a protective wall. Or a nerve the insecticides are targeting can be desensitized. When the changes are genetically based, the resistance is passed on to her offspring.
It is a huge issue. You can't stop evolution. You will get evolution of strains that are out there that are resistant to chemicals.
Steve Lindsay is a public health entomologist at Durham University in England.
If you want to develop control against this mosquito, you have to get yourself into the head of the mosquito and think like a mosquito.
Each species is a specialist with its own feeding strategy. So if it's malaria-bearing, indoor, night-feeding Anopheles mosquitoes you're up against, bed nets are the answer. Bed nets have saved millions of lives. What's next are window and door screens. Lindsay is introducing them in West Africa, and already they've cut the number of bites in half. But screened out, these mosquitoes have adapted. Now, they're outdoor feeders.
So we're left scratching our head, thinking, what can we do?
For years, Winnipeg, the mosquito capital of Canada, has had the answer, spray them.
They're a great foe to fight every day.
Taz Stewart is city entomologist for Winnipeg. Every summer, Stewart orders his ground and helicopter crews to kill larvae with a variety of bacterial insecticides, including one known as BTI.
It's right there, it's a little corn cob. The BTI is a dead bacteria on there. Gives them a bad stomach ache, they die.
It's particularly effective against larvae. Stewart is willing to use a chemical insecticide to fog adult mosquitoes, but it's a last resort. There is something that could stop dangerous mosquitoes in their tracks. Anthony James is a molecular biologist at the University of California, Irvine. Genetic engineering is his specialty. James creates mutant larvae that carry a gene resistant to the dengue virus. Green fluorescence is a marker that tells him it's present.
this is, once again, something you can't see because it's an atomic level almost in a sense. I mean, we're looking at molecules. And so we can build something in a test tube using modern molecular biology techniques.
For that, they need some eggs, which these mosquitoes will lay in a test tube. Only the most robust are selected. Then, with a drop of DNA on the end of a needle, the gene is injected into the eggs. In a couple of days, genetically modified larvae emerge.
So when we look at this and we see the green eyes, we know that this particular mosquito is carrying the gene that we want in it, okay? So it's been transformed, because a normal mosquito would not have green eyes that would fluoresce like this.
Not only that, but future generations will inherit the new dengue-resistant gene. James is also working on one for malaria. He uses the same technique to create a flightless mosquito. It can't fly, so it can't mate and breed, so it can't transmit a disease. Could genetic modification be our ultimate weapon? Or could there be unintended, devastating consequences if millions of genetically engineered mosquitoes were released into the environment? Is it worth the risk?
We think that within the discipline and being very careful and taking phased approaches and having the ability to respond to problems, that I think there's a reason to go ahead and try this. The alternative is to give in to the disease, which is something that is almost as a species we've decided we're not going to do.
If we're going to win the battle, there are many mysteries still to be solved. For Fiona Hunter, that has become her life work.
It fills me with awe and wonder at how that female mosquito can survive in a place like this and be so successful.
In the end, she's a creature of contradictions. She simply wants to reproduce, but that's what makes her dangerous. Her delicate wings are a marvel, but their buzzing sound torments us. Her eyes are stunningly beautiful, but they help her find our flesh. Her proboscis is a perfect model for painless hypodermic needles, but what it deposits in our veins could kill us. Her survival instincts are astounding, but that just means there are billions more of her. One thing is certain. This tiny, fragile creature holds power over us. And so, our battle continues. She was here long before us. She may outlive us.